Hi everyone, it's Plastic EP here from Melbourne, Australia. And let me tell you, it gives me great pleasure to talk to one of the psychedelic rock and roll legends, garage band extraordinaire, Mr. Pepe Castro. And how you feeling today, Pepe?
Hey, I'm feeling groovy, man. Groovy.
Hey, bananas, we think you're groovy. Bananas, we watch a movie.
Watch a movie, yeah.
Driving June buggies everywhere. Just going crazy without a care. Hey, bananas,
we think you're groovy.
Hey, bananas, we think you're groovy. We love to watch you because you're a favorite show.
Hey, bananas, we think you're groovy.
Hey, bananas,
we think you're groovy.
Pepe, let me tell you, this is going to be one of those way out, all the way interviews that you never had before in your life.
Because we're saying hello from up over to you down under.
Yeah, I'm upside down here waiting for the great Pepe Castro to talk to me. Now, let me tell you, let's get straight into the interview. Let's talk about your monkey stories. Let's go for it.
All right. Well, monkeys, let's see. Well, Blues Magoos, which was my first hit record, my first little rock and roll band when I was 16, 17, 18 years old. And we did a lot of dates with the monkeys out on the road. And before they were even the monkeys, there was talk all around Greenwich Village, because Peter Tork was hanging out in the village. And so he was like one of the guys, like the rest of us, that we were all just hanging out, wannabes, waiting to see what life was going to bring from us. And I remember when he came up to me one day and he said, "Hey, man, I got an audition. I'm going up for this band." And he told me the whole story about them. And then, bam, all of a sudden it happened. And the monkeys came out and there was Peter all over the world. It's just like Jimi Hendrix. Jimmy used to be Jimmy James and the Blue Flame. And he used to come into the Night Owl Cafe and jam with the Blues Magoos. And he had his all hair slicked back and his Marseille and everything. And then one day the Animals came down. Chas Chandler saw him, brought him back to England. And 6 months later, he came back as the Jimi Hendrix Experience.
Is that unbelievable or what?
What's that?
That's unbelievable. Now, I've got to also say, I'm going to show you something. A friend of mine here in Melbourne, he's got a big release of a Hendrix book. Look at this. On Saturday, I'm doing an interview. Look at that book.
There you go.
Our Jimmy by Aidan Pruitt. I can't wait for that book release.
Wow.
That's the Jimmy you know, yeah?
Yeah. Oh, I know the Jimmy before that Jimmy.
Tell me about that Jimmy. I've seen some film clips where he's wearing a suit. He's got short hair and he's just a session player in the back.
That's it. It was Jimmy James and the Blue Flame. And he used to play at the Cafe Noir. And I got a nice little clipping that I love where it's of Hendrix with the fro. And he's in a record store in New York. And the clip was Jimi Hendrix is checking out the new Blues Magoos release. He was checking it out in the record store. See, because the Blues Magoos, we came up with the Lovin' Spoonful, Jimi Hendrix, Richie Havens, Bob Dylan, you know, all the people that the Left Bank, all these people that came out of the village in the early 60s, you know, and then there were all the New York bands like the Rascals and the Vanilla Fudge and stuff. So, you know, back then we were at the beginning of the British invasion in the US. So it was just really a handful of bands, you know. I couldn't even walk around New York because if I had long hair, I'd get my ass kicked. Because guys back then, before the long hair and boots took off, they wanted to kill you, man. They were called BBQs, Bronx, Brooklyn, and Queens. And they'd come into the city, and if saw a guy like me with long hair, they'd kick the shit out of you. So I wouldn't leave the village. I would only go from Greenwich Village up to 48th Street, where Manny's Music was. And that was it. And just going from the village up to there, I was taking my life into my hands until the scene got big. And then once all the chicks started going for the long hair guys, then all these Guidos and the BBQs from Bronx, Brooklyn, Queens started saying, hey, let's grow our hair long, man. Let's get stoned. Let's get to drop out because that's where the chicks are.
Man, you lived the life. You lived the rock star life, fair dinkum. You really did.
I did. I think
when
I still
you look back at it, I'm honest, you look so young. You look so
man.
Young.
Hey, well, who do I pay?
No, I'm serious. I don't want you to call me plastic. Listen, you look like one of those English jet fighters that's ready to take off in a jet.
Well, man, listen, I'm here for the ride. You know, I can't, you know, listen, look at me. I'm unshaven. I'm totally funky today. I got my little Grom hat. That's my little invention. I went to Home Depot. Do they have Home Depots where you are?
Yeah, we call them, yeah, they got the, like the army disposals.
Yeah, so they call Home Depot. So I went there and I picked up a grommet set and I slammed it into the hat and I call it my Grom hat instead of a grommet. It's a Grom hat, you know. But
now listen.
You know what? I sit in the sun. I got terrible habits, but music and a good disposition keeps you young.
I got to say something now, Pepe. This is true, man. That song, Nothing Yet, right? It's like, it's amazing. It's an amazing song because if you listen to Deep Purple, right? Black Knight, and somebody mixed those songs together, I'll tell you what, they're pretty close. So you can have Black Knight is a long way from home.
And listen to Ace Frehley's solo on Love Gun, and you'll hear, he does that little run. But I taught Ace Frehley how to play guitar.
Are you serious? Are you close friends with him?
Yes, yes, yes. Ace and I, Ace came, grew up in the neighborhood that I grew up in, right? And when Ace was 10, 11, 12 years old, he was in a gang called the Ducky Gang. And he used to sniff glue. He used to sniff glue down by the railroad tracks. And you could hear him all fucked up, even back then. But I had a hit record when I was 17 years old. So he called up my mother, and he asked my mother, could my mother get in touch with me, and could I call him, and would I show him some stuff on a guitar? And so I called him back, and I said, you know, his name was Paul Frehley, and he was a kid from the neighborhood. And I showed him bar chords. I showed him how to play some bar chords. And he was like, hell, man, if this guy can make it, I can make it. And then, crazy enough, then Gene became, I became close with Gene. I wrote Naked City with Gene. And bless his heart, Bob Kulick, my dearly departed partner in a band I had called Balance, and Vinnie Ponce, we wrote Naked City. I sang on Paul's solo record, you know. I'm really good friends with Paul to this day. I've had tons of fun times with Paul in LA. Oh my God, we were crazy. Paul sang on the Balance on a cut for me on the Balance record. I sang on his solo record. So I'm like part of the history because I'm the guy that inspired Ace Frehley to start his career, you know. And let's face it, he's still the original, man.
That's unbelievable how, see, you got your generation and then you influence another generation. But I just got to say, that meeting of the minds and how you are as a legend.
And you want to know what a small world it is? Bob Kulick, who I knew in the village when I was a little kid, I used to see him in passing. I was like, oh, I know that guy. I never hung out with him, but I recognized him, right? Bob Kulick auditioned for Kiss. He lost out to Ace. So I'm the guy that teaches Ace. And then 20 years later, Paul Stanley walks into my apartment in New York City with Bob Kulick. And I go, wait a minute, I know this guy. And Paul's going, yeah, hey, I want you to meet Bob Kulick. And then Bob Kulick and I start Balance. Paul's brother, Bruce Kulick, ends up being the replacement for Ace for like 12, 13 years. You know, it's like a small, little, incestuous world. There's like, you know, it's crazy.
But these are fascinating stories because I got to say something about Mitch Wiseman. Your friend, my friend. That guy is like, I love him. He's a live wire and he's involved in Kiss too. And apparently he was staying at Gene's apartment and he's telling me stories. Did you ever catch up with him in Gene's apartment?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Well, I would go up to Gene's apartment and he'd go, hey, Pepe, I'll be right out. Sit on the couch and look at some of the portfolios under the couch. So I'd go in there, there'd be like three huge, I'll show your audience, huge, but you know, but we're looking, oh yeah, here we go, huge, well, it would get myself in there. Bigger than, portfolios of hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of checks. And Gene, just for years and years and years on the road, because God bless Gene, Gene's been very, very good to me. Gene called me up one day and he said, hey Pepe, Diana Ross is going in the studio. Do you have anything for her? And without batting an eye, I didn't think I had shit for Diana. But without batting an eye, I went, oh, yeah, Gene, absolutely. I got stuff for Diana. He goes, well, send it over to me. So I start going back to my log and I start doing things and I start grabbing a bunch of songs. And I send her a bunch of songs. And she loved this one song called We Are the Children of the World. Right? Not We Are the World, We Are the Children, but We Are the Children of the World. And what happened was she loved the song. There was a TV show at the time in New York, in the States here called PM Magazine. And they did a half hour special on the song with Diana and a bunch of kids, right? It was the B-side of a song called Missing You. I don't know if you remember, ooh, I'm missing you. Tell me where the road turns.
Hey, right? Sounds a bit like the Rolling Stones.
No, that was a big song because it was about Marvin Gaye's death. Okay. And it was a huge hit in the United States. And I had the B-side on that. So then she asked me, Diana called me up. She said, would you write with me? I was like, oh, yeah, right. No, I'm not going to want to write with Diana Ross. So then I wrote a song called Fight for It with Diana. And that became the B-side of another single. And it was Gene who got me those for Diana. So bless his heart. But 6 months after We Are the Children of the World was the B-side of Missing You. Missing You was written by Lionel Richie, right? Now, who wrote We Are the World, We Are the Children? Lionel Richie and Michael Jackson. So when that came out, see, I know Lionel Richie and Jackson had that song, my song, in their hands like 6, 7, 8 months before We Are the World ever came out. So when that came out, Paul Stanley calls me up and he goes, boy, did you get ripped off. And I was like, what? He goes, oh, man, listen to the song, We Are the World, We Are the Children. They ripped off We Are the Children of the World. And I went, oh, great. What am I going to do, sue Biafra? So what? I just took it on the chin. But it maybe somewhere along the line it inspired them. Who knows? I don't know.
Amazing story. I'll tell you. But you know what? You're in the zone. So what I want to do is I just want to say something now about John Lennon. Charles Rosenau has got a big virtual event called Remembering Lennon, Imagine 80. I'd just like you to say just a few words for the event, and then I want to ask you another question.
All right. Hey, Charles. So listen, so John Lennon, okay? I'm in New York. I'm doing the lead in the biggest Broadway show of the century, Hair. Right? I have a principal role. I'm on Broadway doing the lead in the original Broadway cast of Hair, right? The original Broadway production of Hair, okay? My friend who owned a place called a home restaurant where John was dipping Maypang, that was like the Lost Weekend. I don't know if you know that thing, but Yoko was like, Maypang worked for Yoko and John. She was this gorgeous little Asian girl. It's called The Lost Weekend because May Pang was present, pregnant with Sean, and she was like, May, get John out of the house. He's driving me crazy. Needless to say, John and May had a thing that went on for 18 months, right? And it's called The Lost Weekend. She's had a whole life about it, May Pang. But anyway, my friend owns this restaurant, home restaurant, where John is hanging out. So now John becomes good friends with my friend, who was Richard Ross, who owned the restaurant. Now, I'm calling Richard every other night to tell him to leave the kitchen open because the show's over and I'm coming over with 6 kids from the cast. We all want to eat and drink and hang out, right? So that was my routine with Richard. He'd call me up every night. He goes, you coming over? Because he closed his kitchen at 10. The show gets out at 10, but he would keep his kitchen open, right? So Richard calls me up one day and he goes, Pepe, he goes, I want you to come over to my house at 3 o'clock. And I go, okay, what's up? He goes, I can't tell you. I go, what do you mean you can't tell me? He goes, Pepe, I can't tell you. Just come over to my house at 3 o'clock. I'm going, Richard, what's with the dog and pony show? What? Tell me what the... He goes, just come here. I go, okay, all right, okay, fine. So at 3 o'clock, I go over to Richard's house. He's got a nice little duplex in Manhattan. You know, his restaurant's on the Upper East Side. And I walk in and Richard goes, Pepe, meet John. John, Pepe. And it's Lennon. And I'm going, holy shit, I can't believe it. I don't get flustered over anybody, you know. Everybody takes a dump, so I don't get flustered over anybody. But John Lennon, I was like, all right, I love this cat. This cat's changed the world. I love this guy. So I was like, hey, man, how are you? He's going, oh, mate, how are you, man? Oh, thanks for coming over. And I'm wondering, why the fuck is Lennon thanking me so much for coming over, right? He goes, listen, mate, he goes, your government's trying to deport me. He goes, the FBI's tapped my phone and they want me out of here. And Richard tells me you can get me really good weed. And I get this shit-eating grin on my face like, And I look at Richard and I go, you fuck, Richard. With my eyes, I'm looking at him going, are you out of your fucking mind? You're going to make me John Lennon's dealer? Are you fucking crazy? You know, but at the same point in time, it's Lennon and he wants a favor from little old me in the U.S. And I can't deny him because this is John Lennon telling me his phone's bugged. They're trying to throw him out of the country. And so I go, oh, shit. I go, okay, I'll get you your weed. You know, oh, thanks, mate. Okay, good. So we hang out for an hour or two and things like that. We'd smoke a little, all that kind of stuff. And I go back to my place and I go, oh, shit, I got John Lennon weed now. So I go score him a bag of weed. And I call Richard up. I go, look, Richard, I got John covered, okay? So just tell me when you want me to come over. I'll give him an ounce of weed, you know? So I go, oh, great. And he calls me right back. He says, come on over tomorrow afternoon, 3 o'clock again, you know? Okay. So I go back over. Now I'm going cross town with a bag of weed on me for John Lennon. And I go over there and he goes, oh, mate, thanks so much. Oh, man. And he goes, what do I owe you, man? And I go, John, it's like this. I said, I've gotten so much from you over the years. This one's on me. He puts his hand on my shoulder. He goes, mate, please ease my peasant guilt. And I went, ease my peasant guilt? Holy fuck. And in my mind, I said, you're fucked. You can't say anything back to this. This is John Lennon telling you he just wants to be a normal guy and hang out in New York. And don't buy him his fucking bag of weed. Just give him his weed and charge him money like anybody else, because all he wants to do is be just John Lennon, the unknown guy. So I said, all right, fuck you. Give me $20. You know, I forget what it cost me, but that's the lowest number I could think of that I figured he'd take me. I should have framed the $20. I should have put it on the wall. You know, so he gives me that. And from that moment on, I realized that John Lennon did not want to be John Lennon from the Beatles hanging out in New York. So from that moment on, every time I saw John, which was a bunch of times, I hung out, I was driving him back to the Dakota. I mean, all these kind of things. But I called him Lewis because I knew he didn't want to be John Lennon. Now, you got to imagine, I have hair out to here because I'm doing the lead in Hair on Broadway. I look like a freaking tree, okay? I got an Afghan coat with fur all over it. And every time I see him, I'd go, Lewis, I'm a guy who likes children, you know. And I'd give him a hug, and he would laugh his ass off. And I never called him John ever again. I go, Lewis, what's up, you know. And he'd laugh. He'd laugh it off because he knew I got it, you know. And there's more stories I'll put in my book and stuff like that. But, you know, and then I got to hang out with him, and I'd drive him home. Are you ready for this? At this time, I had a little Volkswagen Beetle, a little bug, right? So now I'm hanging out with him, Dave, and there's this famous actor with him called Albert Brooks. And he goes, all right, I'm going to cut up. I go, hey, man, you want to ride back to the Dakota? He says, yeah, sure. Okay. So me, John, and Albert Brooks hop in this little Volkswagen Beetle. And I go, and I look at him, I go, this is fucking insane. I have a Beetle in a Beetle. And I pull up in front of the Dakota gates and everything, and out pops John. I had this little freaking Volkswagen Beetle, this little powder blue Beetle that I used to run around town, you know, just priceless memories. Priceless.
Yeah, Pippi, I've got to ask you, I want you to say something. If you had to talk to John, right, we're going to play this at the start of Imagine, Remembering Lennon, Imagine 80. If you can just send him a message now, and then we'll take it out of this clip.
Sounds great, man. You ready?
Yep.
Hey, John, I know you're up there looking down on all of us, telling us to imagine about love, but here's to you, buddy. Have a good spliff on me and make sure all those angels up there are fucking higher than a kite and enjoying the universe.
How do you beat that?
I don't know, man. I hope it's that good for me when I get there.
You know, you just led an amazing life. But as I said, being with the Blue Magoos, I mean, isn't that a great name? And people came up to you. Did anybody ever come up to you and say, I used to watch, what's his name, the Magoo, the cartoon show, Mr. Magoo?
I get so much crap you can't even imagine. I love it when I get people that say, I met my wife at the first, our first concert was the Blues Magoos. I met my wife at the Blues Magoos. When you hear stuff like that and people pass on generations and they tell you stories and all this kind of stuff. And even though, you know, the Blues Magoos were banned, our second single got banned because we were like a psychedelic rock and roll band. So everywhere we went, we got strip searched. If we flew anywhere, you know, meanwhile, all the guys smuggling were all guys with long hairs and little wigs to make them look like they had little crew cuts. And we say, no, man, we're hippies. We're not going to carry shit. This the straight guys over there that are smuggling all the crap in, you know, and stuff like that. But our gear would get compounded and they'd open up. They'd go through everything and stuff like that. But the Blues Magoos got banned on their second single, which was called You're Having a Pipe Dream, because radio was, ooh, this is about drugs. Really, the song was about come back to reality. You're having a pipe dream. Don't get hung up on drugs. But the mere title of it show that was our follow-up record here in the States to We Ain't Got Nothing Yet. So when the follow-up doesn't make it, everybody calls you a one-hit wonder, you know. But the stories and you know, I went on to just do things my whole life. I've never stopped. Even to this day, things come to me. And, you know, once I realized that in my life, that I shouldn't be anxiety ridden and freak out and just put good stuff out there. What you put out is what you get back, you know? And so I just made a pact to myself years and years ago to just keep your karma good. You know, don't write songs that are evil. Don't write negative stuff. Just put positive things out in the world. And right now I'm working on a musical in London with, it's really hush, hush. Maybe I'll tell you off air because you'll freak when you hear it.
Now, but you can tell me a little bit and make it like an exclusive for my show. I mean, I'm in Australia.
Yeah, I know, but I still can't say it because there's so many people involved.
Okay.
But I have a minor role in it. I have six songs in it that I co-authored with a buddy of mine from Balance, a guy named Doug Kitsaris. And it is going to be major. You know, I mean, listen, Broadway can close on one night, but I can't imagine this because I'm just not at liberty to say yet. But sure. I know they casted in London, and the songs that I wrote are being recorded now in London, and it's huge. It's huge. And my former manager, who's a partner on me, I wrote a musical in the last few years called Rockin' the Planet. And I did a little black box theater on it in 2019. And we instantly won a Globe Award in San Antonio, Texas for this thing. It's a pop opera. I used all kids. It's based on classic stories from the Bible in the first act. And then the second act goes to the here and now with all the mayhem and the craziness and stuff like that. And as done by kids, you know, and the kids, they sing their hearts out. It's a pop opera. And when you see kids like playing adults, I've got like a teenage god. It's something fierce, you know, it's really good. But like everybody else, I'm shut down. They can't, nobody can do anything now.
Pepe, I've got to ask you, we're live and we've got a lot of texts now. People want to ask you questions, so I'll go through the questions with you, okay?
Go, fire.
I got Charlie DeCosa, a good friend of mine. He said, did you play the Truly Hellers in The Village?
Whoa, who came up with that?
That's my friend Charlie DeCosa from Florida.
Wow. Okay, so here's the thing, because in my book right now, I just finished the chapter on the Allman Brothers. Okay. The Blues Magoos played the Eighth Wonder, which was owned by Trudy Heller's, which was owned by Trudy Heller. The Eighth Wonder, Joel Heller owned the Eighth Wonder. But a group called the Allman Joys, with these two lanky brothers who were teenagers up from Macon, Georgia, played Trudy Heller's, and me running around from the Magoos, we were walking by and the door opened up and we heard this music come out. We went in and we took a peek and we saw Greg, like an 18, 19, 20 year old Greg on a Hammond with his platinum blonde and lanky Dwayne and stuff like that. And we introduced ourselves to them. We friended them. They came back to the hotel. They stayed with us at the hotel. Their gear got ripped off. They had a little trailer and a van that they were drove up to New York. All their gear got ripped off. The Magoos lent them amps so they could finish their gig. We told them to grow their hair long, to stop playing covers, to come down and see us at the Night Owl Cafe, which were the coffee houses where you could play original music. See, in the bars, you couldn't play original music back then in 1966. You could only play covers. And we said, you got to do this, man. You guys get drop out, man. Grow your hair long. You know, write some original songs and change the name of your band. And we stayed friends with them. And then, boom, they came out as the Allman Brothers. You know, but the Allman, but I don't remember if the Magoos played Trudy Heller's or not. We may have. If we did, it was only one night. See, because we played either Trudy Heller's or the Eighth Wonder. Because the guys who were starting to manage us said, listen, the booking agents won't go to a coffee house because they can't drink. You have to get a gig where we can drink. But I'm 16 years old, 15 years old at the time. You can't get into those places and play unless you're 18 years old. Plus, in those days, the law was you had to have what was called a cabaret license. No matter what your age was, you didn't play a bar in New York unless you paid money to the city for a cabaret's license. And you had to show you had a cabaret's license. So I had to buy a counterfeit phony cabaret's license on the street so that we could go in and play. And we were supposed to play for a week. We hated it so much, but an agent from William Morris came down, saw us play, said he'll book us. And then we leaked to the club that I was underage and we got fired immediately because we didn't want to play in the bars. We hated it. We wanted to be with all our hippie friends smoking weed in the other part of the village, in the coffee houses, you know? So, yes. But so the short answer is the Magoos probably did a night maybe in Trudy Heller's, and we definitely played the Eighth Wonder.
He wrote here, he thought it was called Versailles, if he remembers right.
It was called what?
Versailles. V-R-S-A-I-L-L-I-E-S.
Was he in a band called that, or the place was called that?
He said the place was called that. I think it was called Versailles.
Ah, then that's probably after it was Trudy Heller's.
Sure.
You know.
Now, I'll go to the next question.
Okay.
Right. He also wrote Bruce played with Good Rats too.
No, the Good Rats had the only other Pepe on the entire East Coast, which was a guy named Pepe Marcello. Pepe Marcello, rest his soul, he's passed on. He was the lead singer of the Good Rats, which was a Long Island band. When the Good Rats were on Long Island, I was in a band called Barnaby Bye. And Barnaby Bye, we met in the Broadway cast of Hair, myself and the Alessi brothers. Then we sounded out a drummer named Mike Riccadella, who was in an infamous New York band called The Illusion, and later went on to play with a lot of different people, Alice Cooper and stuff like that. And Mike was our drummer. But we became very, very popular. We're in the Long Island Music Hall of Fame. And we got signed on our first gig. Can you imagine? On one gig, we got signed, not just by some little guy, by the biggest guy in the record business, who at that point was Ahmet Erdogan. Ahmet Erdogan was the head of Atlantic Records. He started Atlantic Records. So, you know, he had Bette Midler. He had, you know, Zeppelin. I mean, he had everybody, you know. And Ahmet saw us in this club because we opened up for a woman named Mary Clayton, who had just come off the road with the Rolling Stones, and she was signed to Atlantic. So we opened for her, and Ahmet had to be in the audience. He just came up with us, took us back to his house, and he just told us flat out, I want you guys on the label. 2 weeks later, we were signed to Atlantic. It's crazy. But Pepe Marcello is the Good Rats.
I don't know why he wrote Bruce. He said Bruce played with the Good Rats.
Bruce who?
I don't know. Couldn't be Gulick. Gulick, no.
I don't think so. Bruce played with a lot of little people.
I don't know. He just wrote here, Bruce played with the Good Rats too. That's what he wrote.
It could be. It could be, you know. Bruce.
Anyway, I want to say Eva Van Syok says a big hello to you too.
That what?
Gary's wife, Eva Van Syok, says hello.
Oh, yeah. Gary and Eva. You guys, Mitch Weissman, come on. This guy's a trip. I don't know what he's on, but I want a case of it.
All right. Now, listen, I got another message here from Jimmy Pappas. He goes, hey, Pepe, it's Jimmy Pappas.
Oh, UMO. Jimmy. Jimmy is an amazing musician. When I crossed paths with Jimmy, his forte at the time was he played with drums for me and my dear wife, Willie Blue, God rest her soul. She passed away almost 15 years ago, if you can imagine that. She got a real, real deal. But we had a band called UMO, Unidentified Musical Object. And Jimmy was our drummer. Hey, Jimmy. I love it.
All right. I just got to say, Charlie's come back to me and said, Bruce Kulick did an album with him. He did an album with the Good Rats.
Wow. Okay. All right. I saw Bruce on two nights ago. There's an online thing called, I think, Artists Lockdown or something, or Artists in Lockdown. And Carmine was on it, Carmine Appice, right? I got a song I wrote about suicide, and I sent it to Carmine. Carmine, do you know Carmine Appice?
Yeah.
Carmine, Vanilla Fudge,
yep.
Cactus, Beck, yep. Bogart, and Appice. Oh, my God, you name it. Drum Wars with his brother Vinny and stuff like this. So the host had Carmine on, and an hour before, I had sent Carmine an email saying, hey, man, listen, you know, let's get your drums on this thing and let's just talk about the song. I mean, I played everything. I did all the parts and all this stuff. But I figured, you know, it'd be nice to get Bruce on it because I don't know if you're familiar with the band Balance. But Balance is a band I had here in the States in 1980, 81. We had a top 20 hit in the U.S. And we're kind of revered in parts of Europe as an all-time great shoulda, woulda, AOR band, you know, and stuff. And it was myself, Bob Kulick, guy named Doug Katsaris. And then we used different drums and bass. On the first album, it was Andy Newmark, Roxy Music and tons of everything. Andy Newmark and Willie Weeks. They were Arif Mardin's rhythm section on a tremendous amount of records for Atlantic Records. And then on the second record, it was Chuck Burgee, who's now Billy Joel's drummer, and Chuck's played with everybody, and a guy named Dennis Feldman. And so, you know, I want to do something one one more cut to put out there for balance, you know, and I'm thinking to ask Bruce. Bruce, if he's out there, anybody knows Bruce, I'm thinking to ask Bruce to do it because he's the closest relative to Bob, you know, he's his surviving brother. And they were such a dynamic guitar playing duo together, these guys, that I thought it would be nice if Bruce could play in a cut. So anyway, I sent Carmine this email and I say, hey man, let's just get your drums on this and then we can talk about it. I said, maybe I can ask Bruce Kulick if he'll play on it, you know. And there's another guy named Tommy Denander. I don't know if you know Tommy. He's from Sweden, but he may be one of the most famous guitar players in the world right now. He plays on everybody's record, an amazing guitarist. But I said that and then Carmine says, hey, turn on Facebook. I'm on the air. And I turn on Facebook and boom, they go, and now here's Bruce Kulick. And so there's like, we're split screen. All of a sudden there's Carmine and Bruce. And I'm going, son of a gun. You know, we all know each other. It's such a small business, you know. But we'll see where it goes. I'm now doing one-offs with people I love. I mean, I'm 71. So what I hit 71, I hit my 70s and 71, I said, you know what? From here on in, because I don't need to work. I mean, by the grace of God, I don't need to work, you know? I mean, it's not that I'm that wealthy. It's just that I worked hard. And, you know, if I just live within my means and my pensions and everything, I can coast. That's why I love sitting down here. I got the water right out the door. I go to the beach whenever I want. I got a satellite studio here, one down the block, one in my house in New York. And when shit comes to me, I just do it, you know. So another one of the guys I really love is a guy named JJ French. Now, JJ's the original guy from Twisted Sister. JJ actually owns the name. But JJ proceeds to tell me a story that when he was 14, he walked into the Night Owl Cafe when I'm 16, and he was touching my amp. And I said, hey, kid, get your fucking hands off my amp. And he says he was traumatized. And I'm going, JJ, no way. That's not me. I would never do that. I would never. He goes, Peppy, I'm telling you, you said, hey, get your fucking hands off my amp. And so I guess to this day, he's followed me and we've become good friends all these years later. So I sent him a bunch of stuff the other day. I said, JJ, would you consider doing something with me, a one-off? I don't care what we do with it. I don't care what we call it or anything. And he said, I'd be on it. I was like, great. So I got Carmine. I got JJ now up. I'll probably do something with Balance. I want to get something with Bruce and things like this. You know, I got my musical to think about. I've got this new thing that's really, I'm a baby player in it. But because everybody in it is so like A-list that I'm in the theater world, that I'm just happy to even have my name on the same page, you know. And the work I did is great, so it'll be good. We'll see where it goes, you know. But because the people who are producing it, they paid so much money to option it, because it's such a well-known entity that you know, I'm sworn under confidentiality, yeah, not to say anything.
That's okay. Yeah, it won't be the first or last interview we do.
Yeah.
I mean, well, you know, friends here in Australia. Cool. Yeah. So it's no problem.
Oh, there's an act in Australia called the Something Country Club. Do you know who these guys are?
No, who are they?
They're like a cover band, right? And I found them online. And they're called the Hilton or the something country, a country club. They're a bunch of great musicians. And all they do, they've got a rotating bunch of key players. And all they do is they, let me try and, I don't want to lose you. Let me, new window. Let me try and do this. And they're called the Hilton or something country club or something. And, I've grown to love them, you know. I texted them once, and they said, oh, great man, glad you're in the audience. And I said, that's great. Then I texted them again. I never heard back from them because they're getting big, you know. But they're really kind of cool. And I'll have to send it to you.
I think I'm sure you'll find it. But let me tell you something, Pippi. You talk about your age, but to me, you look 45, 50.
Oh, God bless you, man.
That's you're looking up your age. I'm dead sick. Man. And hey, you're still rocking it.
I got a knot in a piece of twine here, you know.
Hey, listen.
I've never done that.
You're rocking it like the Rolling Stones. You're still rocking it out like the Rolling Stones.
Yeah, I still got some guns left. I guess that's what you call it. If I can find these guys, what are they, guys? Shit. I can't find
them. I'm sure they'll turn up.
Oh, well. But anyway, they're an Australian outfit. And they keep growing and growing and growing. And they're like, it's called the Country Club or something. Something Country Club.
Can I tell you a band I like, Australian? I want you to check them out.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. Are you on iTunes by any chance?
No.
Okay. You on Spotify by any chance?
No. No, you see, I'm a recluse.
Sure, because, okay, I understand.
Because I'm such a songwriter that, you know, I was taught when you're young, great songwriters told me, Pepe, if you're going to pick from the winners, you know. Okay. If you're going to borrow from the greats, you know, and then put it in the blender and come up with something else, you know. And so years ago, I mean, stuff filters to me through friends and I hear stuff all the time, but I don't go out of my way to listen to fresh things because I know it seeps into my channel up here and okay. I don't want to rip anybody off. So I try and be as organic as I can.
Pepe, this isn't new stuff, right? This band is called The Angels, right? They did a song called Am I Ever Going to See You Again? The lead singer's passed away. Wow. I want you to look up from Australia, The Angels. And one of the songs is what I said. Am I Ever Going to See You Again?
The Angels.
No Secrets is another song. They got it. What happens is they were the opening act for AC/DC. And they were under Albert's in Sydney. That was their production company, but they went big. And then they went overseas, and they were opening act for a big act overseas. And the opening act said, we don't want you because you're better than us.
Son of a gun. Unbelievable, man. There's a few angels here. There was a band in New York called Angel.
I know, but type in The Angels Australia and see what comes up. They did a song called No Secrets. But the thing is, if you go to YouTube, am I ever going to see your face again?
Ever going to see your face again?
That's the one. You played that, and that song is killer. These guys, and I mean, oh, I've good. Grown up in Australian music. I rate them as the best songs and the best sounding band. They're not AC/DC. AC/DC was bigger. But to me, when it comes to songwriting, to me, they're it. I want you to play that song and check it out.
Oh, good. I'll tell you. Yeah, they got a bunch of stuff. They got 1978, Take a Long Line, Angels Official Greatest Hits. There's a lot of stuff. Good.
I got some messages here for you. Let's go again. Charles Rosenay wrote, Pepper really peppers his language.
Wait, listen, this is the only time I can act out. I'm shut in. When do
Here's
I get
another one?
When
Most
do I get
a New York band was Dirty Angels?
Probably. I don't know them, but.
And Jimmy Pappas wrote, we had fun playing good times back in the 80s.
Totally. Yeah. Pappas was great. Great musician. Another guy, he plays everything, you know. I mean, he was playing drums with me, but I see now, since we're friends on Facebook, I see, you know, he gets around on everything. Like me, I'm the same way. When I sit down to work, I fill up the paper, you know. I play the bass, play the guitar, play the strings, play the horns, play the keys, play the drums, to, you know, just do the whole thing. That's the fun of it.
Exactly. Now, Pepe, before we go, I'm going to ask you a question about the Blue Magoos, all right?
Right.
When you look back on the history of the Blue Magoos, tell me your favorite television performance when you were playing your hit song. Which is the one? Tell me a story.
I got a few.
All right,
I got a few of them, but I gotta say the single most one is. Do you know who Jack Benny was?
Yeah, of course I know Jack Benny, the comedian, had his own show.
That's it. Yeah, so you know he was huge in the U.S. And when I was a kid, on Saturday nights, my mother used to love Jack Benny. And I remember like falling asleep on my mother's breast, you know, like being a little kid, 6, 7 years old, just trying to stay awake. And she'd be laughing and watching Jack Benny. This was like, you know, that was it. Saturday night, she'd watch the Jack Benny show and all this kind of stuff. And then one day, I'm 17 years old, 18 years old, and I'm on the Jack Benny show. I'm on Jack Benny. It was actually a special, a family special called The Kraft Musical. Jack Benny was the host. Liberace, Henny Youngman, and Maury Amsterdam. And for the kids, the Blues Magoos, right? So there's a clip floating around on YouTube now where the Blues Magoos condense a 7-minute song of Tobacco Road down to 2 minutes live on that show with Jack Benny. And being on that and American Bandstand, you know, I grew up, I used to run home from school to watch American Bandstand, you know, with Dick Clark. And so those kinds of things, doing those kind of TV shows was great. Somebody sent me an obscure, there was a show in New York called The Clay Cole Show. And it was a local show. It wasn't syndicated all over. It was a New York show, which came in on WPIX Channel 11 in the New York market. That was the first TV show I ever did. And Richie Havens, it was the first TV show he ever did. And I have a long history with Richie. You know, I met him when I was 15, you know, and he just changed my life. I love Richie so much. I'm so sad he's gone, you know. But somebody sent me a clip of our second appearance on the Clay Cole Show doing We Ain't Got Nothing Yet, probably 4 days ago. And I've never seen it throughout my whole life. I've never even seen it. But I did get to meet Clay Cole about 8 years ago. After all that time, he was in Florida and I was doing a bunch of dates with the classic old vocal group Jay and the Americans, because I re-recorded all their hit records for them because they don't own their masters. So when they go out on the road, they wanted to record their own music for themselves so that they could sell themselves and they didn't have to buy their own records back from the label. So I did all of those for them, and then I did a bunch of dates with them live. So when I heard Clay Cole was the MC, you know, it was all like the Jay and the Americans, the Drifters, Little Anthony and the Imperials, you know, there would be all these great old doo-wop shows. I went up to him, and I was like, oh, my God, and I introduced myself to him, and I told him what a thriller it was, and he was like, he couldn't believe that I was in the Blues Magoos all that time, and then it must have passed away 2-3 years after that, you know. But again, when people dig and find things that I've never seen my whole life, it's like the name of my book is going to be called The Prince of McDougal Street. And the reason it is, the Night Owl Cafe was on 3rd and McDougal Street. It was right on the corner there. And there was a guy named Alan Merrill. I don't know if you all know Alan. Alan passed away from COVID-19. A few months ago, devastating. Alan wrote, "I love rock and roll. Put another dime in the jukebox, baby." Yeah.
And he was in a bit and the Blackhearts.
Yes, and he was in a band called the Arrows. And about 8 years ago, he and I were guests on a radio show, and Alan went, "Oh well, Pepe's the Prince of McDougal Street." And I looked at him and went, "I went, what are you talking about?" He goes, "Pepe, you're the Prince of McDougal Street." I said, "What? Where'd you get that from?" He goes, "You never heard that?" I said, "I never heard that a day in my life." He goes, "Pepe, you got to be kidding me. You never heard that you were known as the Prince of McDougal Street?" I said, "Never." He said, "Pepe, when you left the Night Owl and you went to the corner and you walked past all the crowd of people, they'd say, that's Pepe Magoo. He's the Prince of McDougal Street," when I'm 15, 16 years old. And I went, "I can't believe it." I went, "That's the name. That's the title of my book." So that's what I'm about 60 pages in now. It's called The Prince of McDougal Street. I'm doing it with a journalist buddy of mine named Henrik Olsen, who talked me into it. After years of people asking me to write a book, it took a journalist from Sweden. And I said to Henrik, I said, "Henrik, you know what? If I can see myself through your eyes as a European, I said, then that'll be fun for me. I'll do it. And so he flies over. We have fun. I put him up. We go walking around. He videotapes me everywhere. We've got a whole package going. It's a lot of fun. So, hey, man.
Hey, that's going to be fantastic when it comes out. But all I can say is you haven't got your guitar handy, have you?
Oh, shit. Let me see. Oops, sorry for the cursing. I don't know why I'm cursing so much. Maybe it's because I know I can, you know, because most of the time you don't.
Have you got a guitar there or not?
I got one here somewhere. Anyway, you ask any people who know me and they say, no, I'm not really a cursor. So
it's all right. I'm sure everyone out there is loving it. All these texts.
My apologies to everybody for being a street kid from the Bronx.
No, it's good. They're loving it. Oh. Wally gets his guitar. They're loving it.
All right. Let's see what I got here.
What do you got?
I don't even know. This is like a little Martin guitar that's not even made out of wood. It's a composite because in Florida I figured the wood would warp, you know. Can you even hear that?
Yeah, listen. Can you play the hit? Come on. Da, 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 da.
Oh, yeah. This is a song I put together for me and Richie Havens, because when I met Richie, I was 15, and he had this song called Follow, which took him 2 weeks to learn, and I never got to do a duet with him. I was in his videos and stuff like that. But I took one of my songs and that song Follow, and I made it a song as a marriage between the two of us. And I don't mind. Oh, let me see. Breaking out of the sky, you came. You blocked out the sun in my eyes. Could never have. Oh, why do I feel so blessed with your love? You're the only one that I've been thinking of. And if everything in life ain't what it seems, then don't mind me. 'Cause I ain't nothing but a dream. Ooh, but a dream. Like the rain falling down, I fell. Now I can look all around. My life opened up. Oh, and all with the strength of your touch, it's clear to me that there's no place that I'd rather be. And if everything in life ain't what it seems, then don't mind me. 'Cause I ain't nothing but a dream. Ooh, ooh, but a dream. And I will follow, yeah. Anyway, you get the idea.
That was beautiful. Now I gotta ask you, with it, you wrote a Kiss song, yeah?
A what?
A song for Kiss.
Oh yeah, yeah, Naked City.
In Can the I hear Naked a City.
I haven't played it in 40, 30 years. Whatever. There it is. I got to relive it. In the Naked City, there are 10 million stories. something like that.
It's amazing.
Oh, it went down the half step again. Yeah, if I got put the memory banks in do that. This was.
I gotta tell you, how great was that song "Hair" by the Carcells? That was unbelievable.
Hair. Oh yeah, oh "Hair" the Carcells. Yeah, it's funny. I you know what's funny? The ones that are still around, we all sooner or later cross paths because there's only so many of us left, you know. So recently, in the last few years. I re-met the Castles because we used to do tons of dates with them back in the 60s, the Magoos. The Blues Magoos played a tour for the whole summer of 1967, which was the Blues Magoos, The Who, and Herman's Hermits. And we toured the United States the whole summer of 1967. It was the tour that broke The Who in the United States. And when I tell you, I got out with my an inch of my life because of my Keith Moon stories, I was lucky I wasn't killed because it was just crazy. But I loved him. I loved it, all the crap that he did. And so he'd go, come on, man, come on, let's go out. Let's go out. And every time I went out with him, I mean, clothes ripped, I'm bleeding, you know. I mean, Keith, I'm serious. The tour gets into Chattanooga, Tennessee, right? We have our own plane. Everything's on there. The souvenirs, the gear, we're all on this big freaking plane. All three bands, we're flying together. We have the floors of hotels, all this kind of stuff. And so when we get to a hotel and they got to check the whole tour in and say, you're going to be sitting for half an hour at least, you know? So they go, so the roadies go, all right, guys, yeah. Gonna be a minute. Sit back, chill. Go get a drink. Whatever you know. It's gonna take a while to check everybody in. There we go. So Moon goes, all right, mate. Come on. It's 2 o'clock in the afternoon in Chattanooga, Tennessee, in 1967. He wants to go across the street and get a drink. I'm not even old enough to drink, but he like drags me, and I thought, all right, I'm going out with Keith Moon. This guy's nuts. I love it. Yeah. So I go with him. We walk into a bar at 2 o'clock in the afternoon. Now, you know how bars, it's like, you know, a bar. When you open the door, all you saw was the bar. And about 10 guys drinking at 2 o'clock in the afternoon. Yeah, you know, and the door opens up. I'm in a fake sealskin coat with my hair down. Moon's in his English regalia. The door opens up. All of a sudden you hear dead silence, you could hear a pin drop. And all of a sudden, one of the guys in the bar goes like this. He's sitting at the bar, and this is what we get. Okay, we get like this. He leans back and goes, "Hey, y'all, get a load of these two fairies." And Keith, I swear to God, Keith, without missing a beat, walks over to a bar stool, picks it up, and cracks it on the guy's back. Within 30 seconds, there are 10 guys on us. I won't say beating the SHI, okay? But they're beating the SHI out of us. Both of us are on the floor. There's 10 Southern good old boys kicking us to death, you know? And I get out of the bar. My shirt's ripped, I'm bleeding, my chest is bleeding. Keith's still in there. And I gotta run in. Now, mind you, we got black belts, S Marines, everybody, you know, bodyguards for the tour that are all our roadies. And I go bleeding into the lobby of the hotel. I said, "You better go get him. He's getting killed over there." And they all run over, they get him and they fish him out. And you know, I mean, it's just like, you know. This was typical stuff. This was like daily occurrences. You know, I mean, whoo. And they were young and fired up, you know.
And that's 1967 when the Monkees are big.
Yes, Yes, yes. And the audience was even freakier because Peter Noon, who's a really good friend of mine, we're still really good buddies, you know, sweetheart guy, great performer, you know. He's the headliner because he's had maybe 10 hit records here in the United States. So half of the audiences are moms with their kids who want to see the teen idol Peter, and the other half are whacked out, stoned out hippies that want to see the Blues Magoos and the Who. It's the freakiest audience you ever saw. But that's what they say.
That's like Hendrix. He plays for the Monkees, and then he gives them the bird because the parents are going, what's up with this guy? This is like shocking for our daughters. And he couldn't handle it. He had to leave because everyone's going, we want Davey. We want Davey.
No shortage of stories like that.
That's all screwed up.
God help you if you're an opening act.
I want to thank you so much from the bottom of my heart. Now, we've done an hour. An hour's gone by.
Wait, where are we?
You're flying.
There they are.
It's like you're flying the jet. Now, listen, we've done an hour, 1 hour. That's fantastic, isn't it?
Seems like 15 minutes.
Exactly. Now you've got it. All right, hey, listen.
Daniel, my pleasure.
Just stay there. Don't go. Say goodbye to your fans.
Hey, everybody, all my guys, all my friends, all new fans, everything. You know what? This is what we have to do in this day and age to not even make a buck, but just to keep our sanity and enjoy life. Enjoy life. Life is too short. Just forget all the crap that's going on in the world. Live your best life. Don't buy into all the BS out there. It's like has nothing to do with it. John Lennon had it right. And so did Martin Luther King. You know what? Hate breeds hate. Hate doesn't cure nothing. You know, love is still all we need.
Thank you, Pepe.
My pleasure.